So I wanted to end my discussion of memory systems by discussing a few upcoming technologies. And you know, before I describe those, let me describe what a state-of-the-art baseline memory system looks like. Okay, so that's what I'm showing in this figure over here. I have one high-performance process socket, and on this process socket are a bunch of memory channels. Okay, so it's pretty common for a high-end processor today to have either 3 or 4 memory channels. And each memory channel is going to drive one DDR3 channel. Okay, so over here is a 64-bit wide data bus, and then you also have about 23 bits for address and command signals. And these channels tend to run at a frequency of either 800 megahertz, or you can even get a few frequencies that are a little higher than that. Okay, but you know, because these channels are running at a relatively high frequency, they can only drive a relatively small load, which is why you can only connect a couple of DIMMs or up to 4 ranks to this one channel. Okay, so there's a limit on how much capacity, on how much memory capacity you can associate to this processor chip. If I want to add more capacity, then I would have to reduce the frequency. Okay, so there is this conflict between bandwidth and capacity, where you can't simultaneously increase both. You kind of have to pick one of these two and optimize only that. Okay, so this is clearly a major problem with upcoming systems, because we are increasing the number of cores on the processor, and if you increase the number of cores, you need to kind of provide them with access to a large amount of data, and you also need to have high bandwidth access to that data, right? So you both need high capacity and high bandwidth. So people have tried to consider some ways to increase both of these aspects. Okay, one thing that is making this problem a little challenging is the fact that ultimately, this external data access has to happen through pins on the processor chip. And, these pins, of course, they don't follow the normal rules of silicon scaling. And so we've kind of reached the limits of, how small these pins can be. Okay, and so because of that, the pin count on the processor is not increasing much. So the only way to increase bandwidth into the processor is by increasing the frequency of those pins. That is increasing the frequency of this channel, right? But if you increase the frequency of the channel, then you can also attach fewer DIMMs, right? So that's what leads to this conflict. So let me now explain, one approach that has been used in high-end servers today to try and increase both capacity and bandwidth at the same time. Okay, and there are obviously other penalties that are incurred, and let me clarify what those penalties are. Okay, so coming out of the processor in this case is, one narrow unidirectional link, which is only about 10 bits wide. And going into the processor is a slightly wider unidirectional link, which may be either 12 bits or 14 bits wide. Okay? So, if I'm only using 22 bits to reach a collection of DIMMs, right? So you can already see the punchline in this case. You can see that I'm eventually going to connect 4 DIMMs to this one narrow link. Okay? So previously, I was connecting 2 DIMMs to about 100 pins on the processor. Now I'm connecting 4 DIMMs to just 22 bits on the processor. Okay, so by using these narrow links, I'm increasing the total number of DIMMs that can eventually be reached by this processor. So this is how I'm increasing capacity. And one clear penalty in this case is that if my cache line is eventually being sent back on this narrow 12-bit link, it'll take many more transfers to get the data across, right? So if you use a 64-bit wide channel, then getting a 64-byte cache line requires 8 transfers. If you use a 12-bit channel, it's going to take more than 5 times as many transfers, and so it takes a really long time to get your cache line across. So that's the main penalty. Okay, and you can alleviate some of that penalty by running this narrow link at a much higher frequency, right? So if you run it at a higher frequency, it won't take quite as many nanoseconds to get your entire cache line across. Okay, and these wires can be run at a higher frequency because this link is fairly short. It is a unidirectional link, and it ultimately drives a single device that I'm showing you over here. Okay, so each of these narrow links is running at extremely high frequencies. And so because of that, we've also increased our aggregate memory bandwidth, right? Because it's the same number of pins as before, but the pins are running at a higher frequency, right? So this is how we get both high capacity and high bandwidth. Okay, and ultimately, all of this is being made possible by the use of this chip over here, which is called the SMB chip, or the Scalable Memory Buffer chip. And what it essentially is it's this router chip that allows you to get to multiple DIMMs. Okay, so at one end of the SMB chip are these narrow 12-bit and 10-bit links. At the other end are two standard DDR3 links, right? So 64 bits of data in each case. Okay, and they're running at a much lower frequency than these high-speed links over here. Okay, so ultimately, you know, these DIMMs are being multiplexed onto a single 12-bit link that feeds the processor. Okay, so, you know, this is how I'm providing both high capacity, high bandwidth. The main penalties are that it's going to take a little bit longer to access the data because, as I said before, it takes many more data transfers on this narrow link over here. And you're also having to navigate through an additional chip. So all of that increases your latency. You need an additional chip on your motherboard, which also increases the cost of your motherboard. And then ultimately, you know, this SMB chip has a pretty high power overhead because it's running at an extremely high frequency. Okay, and so, you know, those are the main penalties of having to go with an architecture like this. But very often, you know, many modern workloads and many modern servers demand extremely high capacities and extremely high bandwidth. And this seems to be one of the few ways to achieve that high capacity and high bandwidth. Okay, so if you're willing to pay this higher cost and this higher power penalty, then you can indeed get both high capacity and high bandwidth. Okay, so now let me discuss a few other technology innovations. And as I was, you know, this is kind of a summary that, you know, many of these problems are coming about because processor pin count is not increasing. And, you know, you both need high frequency and high capacity. Okay, and so one upcoming technology which also promises to increase or improve your memory characteristics is called 3D stacking. Okay, so what 3D stacking does is, you know, you have a design similar to this. Let me just clear this out a little bit. Okay, you have a design very similar to this where you have, you know, narrow links, narrow high-speed links coming out of the processor and terminating in a logic chip like the SMB. And then what you're doing is on top of this logic chip, you are attaching a whole bunch of DRAM chips, DRAM memory chips. Okay, and this is called 3D stacking technology. And you can have these really low-cost interconnects that go between these many chips. They are called TSVs or through-silicon vias. Okay, and you know, since they're extremely short, they allow you to reach data at low latency and low energy. Okay, so what you're essentially doing is you're eliminating these more expensive DDR3 channels and these DIMMs and replacing it with a package that is much more efficient. Okay, so you can improve latency, you can improve energy, and you can also get, you know, high bandwidth through these links over here. Okay, and so there is a product called the Hybrid Memory Cube, or HMC, which is slated for release sometime next year, right? And, you know, that should really improve the behavior of several memory systems.